We're just so blessed for this wonderful day in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. So blessed that the Spirit of the living God lives on the inside of us and flows out of us like gushings of life. Hallelujah. You may be seated. These gushings of life, these rivers of God. I don't know where you're at, but I'm in the house of prayer. I'm not sure where you're at, but I'm in the house of praise. This is not a lecture hall. This is a glory house. It's the temple of the living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'll offer up praises by the Holy Ghost, because that's what Father wants. I'll offer up praises by the Holy Ghost, because that's what Father wants. Oh, let your rivers flow through me. I think that there's a lot of people who don't understand what Father desires and what He wants of our life. He created us for His praise. I just want to give you an opportunity to go ahead and participate. Let's go run on ahead. I know that if you're bound by the powers of darkness, by sin, by confusion, by shame, by guilt, you cannot participate with such things as this praise. But the blood of Jesus will remove it all away right now. There's an instant remedy. You can draw near with all boldness and confidence. You can come. Hallelujah. 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 I will praise you, Lord. I will praise you, O God. I will praise you in your sanctuary, in a temple made without hands. Hallelujah. In this body that you've given me, O God, it is written of me, Lord, to do thy will. In this temple that you've given me, O God, you created it for your praises. And I praise you. I love you and I worship you. You know, I was ministering to a guy, taxi cab driver, yesterday. And you know, first thing, I got in the cabin and I heard in the spirit, he's Muslim, he's a Muslim. I said, well, where are you from? He said, I'm from Senegal, which is just below Morocco, just west of the Sudan. So I started ministering to him, and after a while went by, because he had to give me a long ride. It was a 45-minute ride. And he said, well, what if you can't ever get to this level to be able to know God and walk with Him and please Him like you're talking about? I said, no, you don't understand. It's not getting to a level, it's a free gift. The problem is that you've had all these models and all these examples that has taught you that you need to try to get to a level. No, you need to participate with the level. The level is all the way to the throne room. The level is all the way to oneness with God. See, it's an unspeakable gift. And the enemy of our soul would cloud it. The enemy of our soul would try to hide it. The enemy of our soul would try to direct our attention away from what Christ Jesus did unto what we're doing. And then, of course, people have been pervert that theologically, and they say it doesn't matter what you're doing. It's positionally with God, you okay? No, that's not true at all. God has given to us a gift of righteousness and holiness that we may be taught of God and learn righteousness and holiness. And you know what? The first thing that the bubble up begins to do is put within the inside of you thanksgiving for what He's done. I tell you right now, I'm this certain of this. I mean, I tell this sometimes to preachers, and they look at me like, you know, there's something that's seriously wrong with me. I don't need to preach. I don't need to minister. I don't need to do anything to be just overwhelmed and so thankful in God. All I need to do is stand around and think about what the blood of Jesus Christ did for me. He did something for me that I could never do for myself, nor anything that I could ever accomplish or anyone could ever do for me, is He washed away my sins in His own blood. And then He made a provision that if I do sin, He will cleanse me from all unrighteousness. This morning, I'm going to minister to you from Psalms chapter 51, verse 7. Psalms 51, verse 7 declares we were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. That's where all humanity began. Born in sin. shaped in iniquity. Somebody said, well, you reckon that David's mom had an illicit relationship with somebody and that's what happened? No. No. Sin entered into the world because of Adam's disobedience, and the consequence of sin is death. Be sure your sins will find you out. Listen to me. Because of your iniquity, you will perish. For the wages of sin is death. I just walked you through almost the whole of the Old Testament just now. Somebody said to me, they said, why is the United States of America so blessed? The United States of America is so blessed because of the core of the United States of America was the people of God on their knees praying, crying out to God. The United States of America is a democracy that was born off of doctrines of the Old Testament and the New Testament, and it's written and inscribed upon the monuments of everything that represents this nation, so nobody can come and try to erase and say it didn't exist. It's all just a lie. Amen. And because of that position, the result was blessing. You take heed unto the word of God. I was walking around with, I was thinking about Daniel yesterday. I, of course, did this with most of my kids, but Daniel, I did it with Joshua. Just a period of time I was going through, I was just like, Lord, how did I get so blessed? And the Spirit of the Lord tell me, because you took heed unto my word. That's how the United States of America has gotten so blessed. Now we're in a time and a position in the United States of America where we want to change everything. And so they're changing everything. They're changing the laws, as it were. They're changing the disposition towards God and our identity and who we are so that they can accommodate everybody else. And what they're hoping is they're hoping for a good outcome. I already know what the outcome is. See, God made all of us prophets just by His Word. His Word allows us to see what would be in the future because the Word of God allows us to see the consequence of every act. The consequence of righteousness is blessing. The consequence of sin is curse. The consequence of obedience to God is life. The consequence of disobedience is death and destruction. Yes. And so we don't have to scratch our head and wonder how that's going to turn out. What we have to do is begin to cry out to God and say, look, I understand what needs to happen in order for there a change to take place. And I want you to grab a hold of this with me. I want you to grab a hold of the thought, I was born in sin and I was shaped in iniquity. I want you to understand that at the very beginning of your life, your whole dimension of who you are, your spiritual nature, your spiritual character, what you basically were going to do by nature was absolutely fashioned after a demonic realm. You didn't grow up to be nice and sweet and wonderful and acceptable to God. You grew up to be hateful, ugly, and a creature that is worthy of damnation, to be taken and destroyed. Why? Because every day you were shaped and taught how to walk in strife and how to walk in hate and how to walk in suspicion and how to walk in criticalness and how to walk in murdering. And, because God equates hatred to murder. He even equates lie to murder. Yeah. Yeah. And then everybody just is high-fiving you because it's a big, cool thing, If you don't have anything else to talk about, if you can't talk about the weather, talk about somebody else's character. Talk about somebody else, slander somebody. Shaped in iniquity. To live with a lustful eye, having an eye full of adultery, cannot cease from sin. To be constantly more given towards the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye and the pride of life. That seems to be that which is going to give me happiness and pleasure and that which I cannot live without. Why? Shaped in iniquity. Because of disobedience, sin entered into the world. And because of sin, death was the consequence of that sin. Because of disobedience, Satan became the prince of the power of the atmosphere. Somebody told me the other day, I heard someone saying, and listen to me, you'll understand, it's very important that you have peer review when you try to go into biblical language study, because I heard somebody saying, we ought to translate the Greek word for heaven, we ought to translate it atmosphere. I said, no way. Well, I didn't say no way, because I was in my mind, I said, no way, that's so totally wrong. I wasn't in a position where I could speak. But at any rate, there's a big difference between heaven and the atmosphere. Huh? Heaven is a place of where God reigns in authority. Heaven is a realm, really, that has and really speaks of every dimension of the unseen realm. But the atmosphere, Satan has the control of it. If I could get God's people to have that much discernment, you become fit and equipped to be able to stand against the wiles of darkness, the wiles of Satan, the wiles of of your the enemy of your soul, who hunts you with the net of sin and iniquity to destroy you forever in hell. People don't believe it. People don't believe that God has created an eternal torture chamber called hell. They don't believe it. I had a girl respond last Sunday. She came up to the altar. I don't know whether she was. I could tell right off the bat that she wasn't coming because she was responding to the Holy Ghost, because I could see all this uncertainty on her. I said, listen, I'll tell you right now, what you're asking for, I said, what you think you might have by coming up here is not available to you because you're too uncertain. I said, and I'm going to help you understand this. Are you ready now to die that you may live again? Are you ready to end a life of sin and iniquity? See, people think that Jesus Christ came, died at Calvary's cross to make sin okay. He didn't. He came and died at Calvary's cross. I want you to listen deeply to me. I know that many of you may think that you know this and understand this, and that's fine, but I want you to listen deeply to me, because many times we think we know something so well that we miss it. I'm telling you, because I know the Lord has taught me where I think I know something so well, and the Holy Ghost goes, hey, listen, let me give you some insight. And then, praise God, we see. So I want you to listen. I want you to listen deeply with your heart. Because we're learning how to yield our members to the Holy Ghost to be taught of God. And if you don't, if you're not careful, you'll disrupt what God the Holy Ghost is doing. You get to drink of this water of life in brokenness and humility. Jesus Christ came to deliver everybody who wanted to come out from under the tyranny of Satan. Everybody who received enough light and insight from the Holy Ghost, which light and insight has been made available to all men, to recognize that sin is evil and it's ugly, and you don't want any more of its pain, and you don't want any more of its destruction. God the Holy Ghost came to show us how beautiful Christ Jesus is, how beautiful heaven is, how beautiful the ways and life of God are, so that somebody could cry out and say, I want to be delivered from this evil of this world. Look, I want you to understand something. Men sit in darkness under the shadow of death, and light has sprung up. But men love darkness rather than light because they love evil. This is a reality, dear people. This is the reality. God, the Holy Ghost, has caused all men to see the light. The light is shining into the darkness right now. Jesus is the light of the world, and the darkness was not able to resist him, so that all men might see the light of life. He is the light that lighteth every man that comes into the world. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. He said, the grace that brings salvation has appeared to all men. But there are many people who would rather listen to the mind of Satan than to the realms of darkness. I'm telling you right now, if I did not have the diet of the Word of God, because it's spirit and life, I would be just as weak as everybody else. I live on the Word. I hunger for the Word. And the more you give yourself to the things of the Spirit, the more you're desperate for them. Why? Because you begin to be less influenced by the atmosphere, by the God of this world, even though God in his grace and mercy came and redeemed us and gave us a new life. Yet still, there is this imposing, relentless tyranny of a rebellious one called Satan, which by definition is adversary, who says, you're mine. And people don't understand how to walk with God, so their prayers are hindered and they're separated from God, and they get barriers and layers that keep them from being able to receive from God. Many things, like dwell with your wife according to knowledge, otherwise your prayers will be hindered. His face is towards, his ears are open and his eyes are open to the righteous, but his face is against them who do wickedly. I mean, there's these things that we would do that would allow, you know, holding unforgiveness, holding offense in our spirit against somebody. It just becomes layers and barriers to where that even as it was in the days of Daniel, because Daniel, here's Daniel, a man and a prophet of God, someone highly favored of the Lord. But because Satan has a pseudo-sovereignty over him, God sends him, is sending him the answer and sending the encounter to Daniel. And Satan is able to stand there and resist God. Just one of his angels was able to stand there and resist God. Provision to Daniel. And to so much so that Gabriel said, I fought with them 21 days in heaven. There were war in 21 days in heaven over this thing. Well, that was that power of Satan has been removed for everybody who's called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, because Satan has been cast out for those who will live over here in the realms of the kingdom of God. But parallel to that is the kingdom of this world. Parallel to that is the kingdom of darkness. You and I got to decide which realm we want to live in. Because Father has given us the opportunity to be born in righteousness. Listen to this. Instead of being born in sin, you can be born again in righteousness. Think about this. Woo! And now be shaped in purity. Because as iniquity literally means to be crooked or perverse or twisted. Ha ha. Pure gives to us the absolute opposite, now walking in everything that is right and straight and clean. Pure, opposite of perverse. To be shaped every day by the Holy Ghost. Now think about this. When you came into this world, from day one until you encountered the Lord Jesus, every day having been born in sin because of Adam's transgression that you read about in Romans chapter 5, because of the effect of Adam's transgression, every day you are being shaped and taught to be like Satan. You are a good citizen of hell. You are good at the lust of the flesh. You are good at the lust of the eye. You are good at the pride of life. You are good at all the things that belong to strife and deceit, and learning how to be better every day. To be more like your father, the devil. Think about it. I want you to hold with me, because I'm telling you right now, I can hear in the spirit, people are dialing 911. Come, it's an emergency. People are telling us, we're being told something about ourselves that we don't want to hear. This is reality. The nature, the character, the ways, the disposition, the way you think, the way that your mind processes stuff. You know, habits, good or bad, you just on automatic with them. You know that? You just on automatic. You know, somebody busted off the door of my tractor, and so just as old, getting older, and got to fix this stuff, period. So bottom line of this, I don't want to crawl over all the equipment and then try to get out the other door. So just, even though I know I can't open that door, I'm constantly opening the door. Going. But it has nothing to do with my thinking. It's the automatic. It's the automatic. It's just that which we have the propensity to do. We're trained to do it. That's the way we process. It's just hard to break. It's like a pathway in our mind, in our thinking, in our behavior, in our manner. Huh? And now after having fixed the door about half a dozen times over and over again, because I keep, and then I locked it. I locked the door. So on the outside, I can't get in. Every time I'm like, wow, I'm so glad I locked this door, because this is about the umpteenth time I've done this thing. And you think, well, I'm stupid. No, it's behavior. It's trained behavior. Unfortunately, on the inside, it just opens every time. On the inside of the thing, I got total control of what I'm going to do. It's kind of like our spiritual nature. On the inside, we got total control whether we're going to choose right or wrong. Huh? And you know, I'm choosing the wrong because it's been right. You hear me? Yeah. Walking with the powers of darkness has been right. People wonder, what's wrong with you that you're not like all excited about the same lust we're excited about? What's wrong with you that you're not so set and bent on your own person, self-interest, prosperity, thinking things? Huh? It takes men most of their life to understand that the better life is living as a servant to others than living to serve yourself. It takes people most of their life because it's opposite to the nature of men. But what does God do? In his loving kindness and in his mercy, he makes opportunity for us to be born again. And then somebody comes along and tells you, oh, you're just as old as you were now that you're new. You're just the same person. Then you're stuck. Now you're stuck. Now you're bad, bad stuck. Because now the only redemption that ever could come to you has left you no different than you were before. And thus, this is the story read of men in the lost and dying world of most Christians. They no different from the rest of us. They just go to church. That's not what the Word of God declares, and that's not what the faith would teach you. And I'm going to help you understand something. Until you come into the faith, you can never live it. As long as you're going fighting in your mind. I watch people. I tell them, declare to them the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. They think they're smarter than me or know something more than I do. And they fight the Word of God. Not me, fight the Word of God in their mind. And they never step into this glorious living in Christ Jesus of those who've been set free by the Son. You know, Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He's anointed me. Come set you free, all you guys that are behind bars, looking through the bars that may wonder how you could ever live this life. I've come to open up the prison doors and set you free from the bars of prison, the prison that Satan has you, and I've come to deliver you from the demonic oppression on your life that won't allow you to do anything else except for that which the God of this world, Satan, would teach you and demand of you. When you look at the tyrants of the dictators of old, Sargon I, Sargon II, you look at all these various different ancient kings, the pharaohs, you look at the Xerxes, etc. These men were just outward expressions of the demonic realm. The way that they subjugated men had no concern for their life. All they were was beings to serve their own interest. And they didn't care nothing about your life or your well-being. All you were was to live as a slave to serve their own self-interest. That's just a small little teeny manifestation of the demonic realm. So you people at a crossroads, are you going to be continue to be taught by Satan? Are you going to begin continue to be more fit for hell? Or are you going to begin now a new life that God has made opportunity for through Christ Jesus, the doorway in and the access into the kingdom of God by being born anew and born again, wherein you're given a new heart and a new spirit? Now God places within us His desires to know Him, to hate sin, to be convicted of sin, to know that it's wrong like never before. Not just be guilty over it. To know that it's wrong like never before. To now every day to be taught by the Holy Ghost to be shaped in His image and His likeness. To be trained as a newborn baby. As a newborn baby now desiring the Word of God so I can be trained. I was trained all my life. I've been trained to be just like the devil. Humanists don't like to think of this. I was ministering to someone the other day, and I was so blessed because they're religious. They go to church. I was so blessed, though, because the Lord put a word of wisdom in my mouth. And I said, listen, from a humanistic point of view, they're humanist. I said, from a humanistic point of view, you can logically justify every condition and state of men and make it acceptable. But as for me, I've given myself to the law and ways of God which are described to me by His Word. And there is no latitude for me to veer to the right or to the left. They woke up the next morning and they said to me, that word was in my mind and my thinking all night. I believe that you're more right than the humanist. I said, I think I am. Oh, I could have stepped up and said, I know I am. Huh, but what's that going to do? What's that going to do? God don't need no help. We have to watch it, people, because I'm going to tell you right now, we were taught more pride and more egotism and more self-reliance and more self-assurance out of the realms of the demonic than ever out of the realms of the kingdom. God teaches us dependency. You can do nothing without me. You don't know anything as you ought to know it. That's what God tells us. Huh? He teaches us dependency. We don't know. We don't understand. Our minds have not been willing to be trained by the Word of God as we ought to be. We've not been willing to conform to lowliness and meekness. We're still living under the influence. Somebody didn't tell us we were set free from it. Somebody didn't show us, or they showed us and we weren't willing to listen, that certain ways and attitudes and behaviors is after your father, the devil, or your former father. Out and then that situation after the wicked one, the god of this world that works in the children of disobedience. We got to take heed into the Word of God. We take heed into our soul. We need to receive the engrafted Word of God, which is able to save our soul. What does that mean? It means that the Word of God now comes into our life, and it's out of the Word of God that we bear forth the fruit of character and conduct and behavior. You understand? That's why Peter says in 2 Peter chapter 1, he said, yeah, you've been given the divine nature. Yeah, you've got a new beginning through the new birth. You've escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Now, give all diligence. Now, be willing to give all attention to the one who's come to teach you, to now shape you, to shape you in the ways of life, in character, in every dimension of the nature of God. I seem to tell many people, it's almost that they were just like, it's all positional, and they just, and even if they don't say it's positional, they act like it's positional because they don't give all attendance. They're not desperate about making sure that they're conformed to the image of the Son. In a dependence of God, of recognizing, wait a minute, is that lowliness and meekness? From day one, to be taught of the Word of God, because the Word of God will work mightily in you. If you believe it, it'll be saying, hey, wait a minute, God wants to shape you in lowliness. You're getting all arrogant now. God wants to shape you in meekness. You're getting all boastful and prideful now. God wants you to understand the beauty of kindness and you being all self-centered, people, self-absorbed. You know, when you self-conscious, self-absorbed, it's hard to be kind. Because all you're too distracted being kind for yourself. Just walking through life, just totally unaffected by everybody else's needs. God wants to build within us and shape within us and develop within us and grow within us and mature within us a great compassion for others, not ourselves. See, people will go walk around and talk about, whoa, poor old me, woe is me. And it's like so compassionate for themselves. And that's based upon what they wanted to get. That's the former conversation. That's the former life for which we use adjectives to try to describe it within the framework of self-interest and division and envy and jealousy and covetousness and greed. That it pales to express what God would teach us. By His Spirit, the Holy Ghost got to be our teacher. We all taught of God. Jesus said in John 6:45, and they shall all be taught of God. From the least unto the greatest. To now be shaped. To now be conformed. To say with our heart, you are the potter. I am the clay. You've made me a new lump, praise God. I'm not some old hard, crusty thing that's stuck looking just like a demonic thing. After the behavior and the manner of everything that you hate and despise, even the best of men, shaped, born in sin, shaped and fashioned. Shaped, same word as fashioned, or to carry the image or likeness of another. Shaped, fashioned in the likeness of the demonic. In a place called darkness, in a realm called darkness, taught of devils, taught of hell, taught of the satanic, taught of death. Jesus said, you dead while you live. John said, he that has Christ Jesus has light. He that does not have Christ Jesus or the Son does not have light. Here the light is shining to the most wicked, to the most crooked, to the most perverse, saying, behold, come, I will clean you up. I will make you new. I will make you straight paths for your feet. I will be your light of life. I will give you a new start. I'll give you a new beginning. I'll fasten you all over again as I did in the beginning. So that the Lord now gives each one of us the opportunity to stand and choose and make the same choice that Adam had. To where now it's not just because of the sin of one. Ah, look, this isn't fair. One man sinned and it came on me. This isn't fair. I didn't get to decide. The Lord gives us everyone an opportunity to be, as it were, the Adam. Male and female. And then the beauty of it is He's made a way that if we disobey and do what Adam did, that if we're sorry, if we're deeply sorry for it, if we're so sorry for it that we don't want that in our life, that we turn from it, which is repentance, He washes and cleanses us so we can get it right, because we want to get it right, and He's here to give it to us the right way and teach us the right way and lead us in the right way, lead us in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. We just act like, oh, well, we just repent for it and then go do it again. What? That ain't repent. That's some religious, I'm sorry. You know what I'm saying? No, repent says, I don't want this in my life. And we've come up with all kinds of doctrine and say, well, the old man's still there. Oh, it's a soulish nature. Well, how are you going to get rid of that? Unless it's by the cross. Unless it's by the work of the new birth. For it will be with you forever. It will be with you forever. For there is no sanctification for which man can work for himself. This sanctification, this separation, this new creation, this new birth. What you have is what God has given to you. Or what Satan has given to you. One or the other. God looks at the most righteous men, as it were, or most religious man of the day. Nicodemus says, you can't come in. I can't come in. No, you can't come in. But I've been serving the Lord. You know, I'm going to make a dialogue here. I've been serving the Lord since I was a wee little lad, 4 years old. I'm going to give cultural stuff in there. I've been serving God. I memorized the Bible before I was six, most of it. By the time I was 12 at my bar mitzvah, I had it all in my heart. What do you mean I can't come in? You must be born again. The way you are is perverse. It is crooked. It is of another nature. It is of another realm. Even in your religious position, you still born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And the only light that they had was the light in which they would hear the word of God and do it. Whatever the word of God they did, that was the only light. That was the only testimony of the living God. Just whatever little thing they may have done in obedience to the word of God, because the word of God brings the life. The word of God declares the ways of the living God. Hallelujah. Here you and I now, we've been born of the Word. Born of the Word of God. Born of the good seed of the Word of God. He has taken, He's put within our hearts His Word by writing His laws upon our heart and His testimonies, our statutes, His governing principles upon our mind and our thinking. In other words, so that we may live by His Word, that we may be doers of His Word. That we may be shaped by the Word. That we may be fashioned by the Word. who the living Word revealed and exposed every dimension of the Word. Christ Jesus is the living Word. Who demonstrated the fullness of every dimension of the Word. He said, behold, or lo, I come in the volume of the Bible. The whole Bible's written about me, and I come to show it to you, to do it, to proclaim it, to reveal it. And now gives you and I the power to every day be conformed to the image. Romans 8:29, be conformed, for He has predestinated us to be conformed. You want to talk about predestination here for a minute? Let me talk to you about predestination. Romans 8:29, He predestinated you to be conformed to the image of the Son, to be shaped, to look just like, act, imitate in every way Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. The Word, the living Word. It's okay, Lord, I'm not very compassionate because I was taught it's the opposite. Now I want to learn how to be compassionate and to become desperate about it. I want to learn how to walk in love. What is that? 1 Thessalonians 4:9. Walk in love one towards another, even as you are taught of God. Huh? To all be taught of God, to then say, wait a minute, being taught of God is ultimately my privilege to be shaped in His likeness, to be made fit for heaven, to understand the ways of life, to step into the blessing, to get out of the curse, to step into the life, to get out of the death, to get into the relationship instead of being the one that is an outcast. I want this, man. I want to learn it. Holy Ghost, I recognize I can't do this without you. Having begun in the Spirit, I can only be made perfect by the Holy Spirit. I have the Word of God on the inside of me. I believe the Word of God. I know that I am a new creation, that everything old has passed away. Behold, everything is new, and everything is of God. And the Holy Spirit has come to lead me and guide me and teach me that I might walk in this endowment of the power of the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision to fulfill the lust and to fill the lust of the flesh, or any kind of dimension of the former life. And all that is found in obeying God's word. Saying, I want, hearing God's word, saying, I want to do that. You know what the Holy Ghost does? I'll empower you. It's like, Lord, speak your word only, and I'll walk on the water. And Jesus speaks his word only, and the power of God, the Holy Ghost, empowers Peter to do something that is impossible. And so is faith in every dimension. You hear the word of God, oh, I want to walk in that kind of compassion. And here's the Holy Ghost going, oh, you do? Okay, come on, I'll give you the power to do it. Oh, I want to walk in that kind of love. Okay, you do? Oh, I want to walk in that kind of purity. Okay, I'll empower you to. Oh, I want to walk in that kind of righteousness. See, God has come and given us a gift of righteousness. Think about it. And the gift of holiness. He who knew no sin became our sin offering that we may be made the righteousness of God in him. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 5:21. Think about it. It's a gift of righteousness. The righteousness of God, which was declared by the law and the prophets, but which the law and the prophets could never get. For if there had been righteousness imparted by the law and the prophets, if life could have been given by the law and the prophets, then the righteousness of God would have been imparted to us. If the righteousness of God could have come by the law and the prophets, then the life of God would be imparted to us. But it couldn't. That's what Galatians 3:21 is about. So Chapter 3 and chapter 4 are about. And the Spirit of the Lord comes and makes us a new creation, fills us with the Spirit of holiness, giving us the gift of holiness, which is encapsulated in this one. You know, we know that we've made our bodies have been made the temple of the Holy Ghost. Wow. He lives and dwells in us, and he walks in us. And then he baptizes us, he's with us and in us. But then it's all encapsulated in a couple of verses of scripture that they're cornerstone pillar verses of scripture, like Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 24 and Colossians chapter 3 and verse 10. And everybody ought to know where those are at and understand that that's who you are. And so I want you to open your Bibles real quickly, and I want you to read that. Open that for me. Sukatara masete remashe katana seya. Bodas denea tikina, bokinea tishipeata. Through the tongues, through the language of the Spirit, the Holy Ghost will teach you how to think his thoughts more deeply, how to speak his words more perfectly. Oh yeah. It's not some kind of religious expression, so we can all sit around and rattle our tongues together. It is rather the indoromasatea is the most sacred and wonderful realm of God's conversation being held on the inside of our life, and the utterance of heaven first being heard through our lips. Come on now. People have tried to defile these holy things of God and wonder why they can't get into the glory. Because you reject God's way. You're listening to the prince and the power of the air, that if he can't hide all that Christ Jesus has done for us, he'll hide as much of it as he can. If he can hide all the gift, he'll hide as much as he can. If he can't make you an enemy of heaven, he'll make you as much as he can. If he can't make you an enemy of Christ, he'll make you as much as he can. If he can't make you an enemy of the Holy Ghost, he'll make you as much as he can. You listen to me? Everything that God says is a beautiful and wonderful gift, and you better get hungry for it. Stop listening to men, because men are liars, taught by their father, the devil. And if they never learn how to speak the truth, because somewhere along the way they were ensnared by religion, Satan is the god of religion. You know, the Lord will put offensive things in my mouth to try the hearts of people. There's times I'll know where people are at, and I'll say something right where they're at, right where it's going to offend them. And I'm like, Lord, you know, I know they're never going to come back now. And the Spirit of the Lord goes, that's fine. It's their choice. I'm going to say, eat my flesh and drink my blood. I'm going to sort people out. As soon as they think they're right, I'm going to show them where they're wrong. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? Is that somebody trying to always put me down and make me the bad guy out? No. It's the Lord wanting to lead us in the right way. He's wanting to show us the things that are wrong. He's wanting us to show us how to make straight paths for our feet. And no longer walk in crooked ways, which is the same word as ways of iniquity, to be perverse, twisted, or crooked, to be bent. Huh? In the wrong direction. Hallelujah. I was bent. I was stuck. Huh? I was stuck like a compass needle on the North Pole or on a magnet. Stuck in the wrong direction. Stuck. No matter how much I want to turn away, stuck. Can't move. Hallelujah. God broke that force. He broke that force. He broke that force of iniquity. He broke that force of hell. He broke that affinity and that claim that Satan had upon us. Amen. To where that Satan could be the one that would blind our minds. You know, sometimes when I'm talking to people and I hear their questions that they ask me, I just simply say, the reason you ask me these questions, the reason that's going on in you is because there is a God of this world. He works in people's lives with a mind-blinding power. So I'll just go right like this. I'll just say this. I'll break the power of that mind-blinding spirit right now. I'm going to come at it. I'm not going to tiptoe around acting like I don't have the power of God so I can be acceptable to men. I'm not going to speak like a scribe when I can walk in the authority of a son. I'm talking to you now. I'm just encouraging you. I'm not bragging on myself. I'm just showing you what you need to be doing. Amen. Hallelujah. They wondered at Jesus because he didn't speak, didn't talk like a scribe and a Pharisee. He talked as one who had authority, and you and I are supposed to do his ministry. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Monday, Renee, but he was full of compassion too. Listen. Love and compassion leads the way. If you don't know how to be loving and compassionate, if you're stuck, many people are stuck in the realms of their emotions. They don't know how to show love. They don't know how to show compassion. They don't know how to let go of those things that have bound them in a world of introvertedness, which is true introvertedness, to be more conscious of your own need than other people's need. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Should it be turned up? In a spirit. Why don't you just ask God, turn me all the way up. Spiritually. Father God, we ask you to give him the max decibels in the spirit. Turn him up so loud, it's ear piercing, makes people's ears bleed. Hallelujah. His deafening sound of the power of God's anointing. See, people hear a lie, and out of that lie, they make their judgments and call it the truth. And thus they spend their life walking around in a lie that they are convinced is absolutely correct. This is the way it is. That's what Satan does. And it happens on so many different levels. People just know a little bit of the picture, or they know a little bit of information, or somebody tells them something. I'll tell you right now, I don't believe nothing anybody tells me, unless they're talking about the world. I don't. I said, I trust my children totally, absolutely more than anybody on the planet. They tell me something, I'll go, no, we got to verify this. I don't believe that. I don't accept that. Let's go look it up. I'll get on the telephone. I'll start calling people. Did you do this? Did you do that? Did you hear somebody say this? I want to hear 2-3 witnesses. Because you know what I understand? I'm smart enough. I've been made smart enough by God to recognize that everybody's wrong in their perception, including me. And just about everything you hear in a conversation, you got most of it wrong if you repeated it. I'm so sorry to tell you, I hate to be the one to break the news to you, be the bad guy. It was proven to you over and again, the test you took in school. But no, you still don't believe it. The teacher was wrong, not you. Right? That was an unreasonable test. Can't believe it. You don't remember going over that in class. It wasn't even the book. No, the reality of it is, if you did a recording of the class, the teacher spent most of the time talking about that. I'm sorry. They just sitting there repeating themselves over and over again on about 5 or 6 issues, and you come on, you're listening to me. I've determined to walk in the Spirit. I've determined to be shaped by the Spirit, to walk in the mind of Christ, to be governed by the Word of God, not to be influenced by all the stuff that people are saying and thinking and doing. I just recognize they lost in a realm of darkness to various degrees. There's no truth there. Nothing in the world is good. All that is in the world is evil. Jesus said, I'm not of the world. The world hates me. Somebody said, we need to make Jesus culturally relevant. As soon as you do, you got another Jesus. He's not culturally relevant. He never can be. The world hates him. The culture hates him. The culture crucified him then and will today. Say, do away with him. It's not right that he should live. He's a blasphemer and an evil man, possessed of the devil. Come on now. Come on, what? Just a little bit of wisdom. The Lord says, Ask for wisdom and I'll give it to you liberally. I mean, just a little bit. Wisdom will take us a long way. But what happens, we ask Father for wisdom and then we begin to waver. We have two judgments and we go ahead and walk in our wisdom instead of doing what God's word said to do. You take a heed to God's word, he'll bless you. Did you know that God has opened up for us every spiritual blessing? Financially, materially, physically, spiritually. The only reason we don't have them is because we curse ourselves. We curse ourselves by participating with the cursed thing. Many people are walking around with a cursed thing in their hand. Got the cursed thing in their hand with their hands lifted up praising the Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Don't even know the cursed thing's in their hand. And then somebody tells them the cursed thing is in their hand. Oh, I can't believe there's any love. I can't believe it. There's no love around here. Ah, he's controlling. Trying to tell us we got a cursed thing in hand. Hey, let me take that out of your hand. You'll get blessed tomorrow. Amen. And for the rest of your life, would you let me take it? Nah, you can't. You don't know what you're talking about. You're controlling. You want everything your way. When a man is speaking after his own understanding and after his own perception, then don't listen. But when somebody's delivering the word of God to you and showing you the ways of God, the ways of the Spirit, hallelujah, declaring those things that are very clearly seen as the testimonies of the living God about that which is cursed and that which is blessed, listen. Drop it. Ah, I didn't know I had it. Thank you, Pastor. You just come, give me a hug. You delivered my soul. You taught me in the ways of righteousness. Hallelujah. So you got to have to understand this. You have to understand that you and I have been given an opportunity to learn the ways of God. We've been given an opportunity to be taught of God. We were born in righteousness. Originally, we were born in sin. We called upon the name of the Lord, and God's grace and mercy made it possible for us now to be born in righteousness. Woo! We were born in sin and taught by the satanic and thus shaped in iniquity every day of our life. All every day of our life, up to the point that we had an encounter with God, and he came and he erased it all. He broke the chains of darkness and the power of the enemy and says, now bring into captivity every thought. Now let every thought be conformed to my word. And let every thought be conformed to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Pull down everything. I'll give you the power. Here, I'm going to give you the power. I'm going to give you divine ability. Oh God, if it's you, speak the word only, and I'll be able to bring down every thought and bring it into captivity and cast down every imagination too. And all my thoughts will be thoughts of you and the knowledge of Jesus. And so the Lord says, here's the power. I give you God power. I give you everything that pertains to life and godliness to do it. See, this is a different gospel than what's being taught. This is the gospel of change. This is the gospel of the life of Christ. This is the gospel of the new life. This is the gospel now as newborn babes, being able to desire the sincere milk of the word, that you may go thereby, that you may learn the ways of righteousness now that you've been given the gift of righteousness, that you may learn the ways of holiness now that you've been given the gift of holiness. Are you listening to me? This is a different gospel than the relevant, culturally relevant gospel that is being taught today. This is the gospel of the Bible. Last Sunday, you might remember, I ministered on 2 Corinthians chapter 11, if they come with another gospel, another Jesus, another spirit. Declaring unto you what Paul was expressing, that which has already been established. You listen to him, he says, you bear with him. But here I'm the one giving you the truth, and you just like despising me. So nothing's changed, has it? So if men are going to just despise Apostle Paul with all the anointing he had, I mean, goodness gracious, I'm really down on the low end of the thing, you know what I'm saying? Of course, I've determined not to come the least bit behind in any of the gifts of the Spirit. My 9-year goal now, because I was a 10-year, but now it's 9, is to come into the fullness of the measure, the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. And there are things, if I'm going to do that, if I'm serious about that, there's things I've got to do. I ain't gonna just happen because I'm sitting around going, oh. Well, we're on our knees praying. Satan broke in and took everybody to hell. You hear what I'm saying? It's time to get up and start moving. Huh? Well, we're on our knees inside praying. Satan worked havoc in the street. Because we created a void. We didn't get out there and do what God said to do. Go proclaim the word. Go announce the word. The word of God is the power of God to break off every yoke, to change people's lives. That announcement of the word everywhere we go. I love announcing the word of God, especially to people from foreign nations that are in America. I've never been to Senegal until yesterday. When the taxi cab driver picked me up, I went to Senegal. He goes back to Senegal all the time. How many times do you think about that? I've never been to some neighborhood or whatever. I'm on the airplane with somebody. I love airplane ministry and taxi cab ministry. They go and send them out as an evangelist. Amen. I mean, that's just... So if I'm not giving myself to the work of the gospel and the ministry of the Spirit, I'm maturing in nothing. Whatever you're giving yourself to, that's what you're maturing in. Hello? Hello? The more you let Satan shut you down in the public square and not allow his word to be manifest to you, the more power you give him to keep you shut down in every realm. Huh? Now God gets a few little squeaks out of you because you gave too much power to Satan over yourself. Do you hear what I'm telling you?
Yes.
Well, I'm telling you the truth. Because it's a spiritual realm. And everybody's paying attention. What are you doing now? Both heaven and hell is paying attention. Now what are you doing? Whose influence are you coming in now? Because I'm going to tell you right now, it's the influence of the spirit of this world, the God of this world is going to keep you from being happy about the one who gave you life. Being excited about the one, hallelujah, who delivered your soul. And being filled with love and compassion not to see anyone else remain in that state of iniquity and sin. Because people that try to, I watch it happen all the time. People just go ahead. Hey, I just want to thank you for those flowers. I was so sick and tired of seeing that the stuff out there. It was almost obnoxious. I'm telling you, it was just that kind of plant doesn't belong in the front of a pulpit. So many times I look at it and I go, my Lord. I would turn my head. Thank you so much. I just needed to do that because I forget. And the heaven and hell, just stand there watching, seeing what you're going to do. Whether or not you're going to be filled with the compassion of God or be influenced by, oh, they don't want to hear. Don't say nothing. You know, I know this because I can feel it. I can sense this. I know. See, I'm aware of what's causing those feelings and those thoughts. You may not be aware of it. You may justify it and don't even know why you're thinking the thought. I'm aware of it because I'm engaged in the spiritual battle. Like yesterday when this taxi cab driver picked us up, I could feel the power, the influence of the enemy. Oh, he doesn't want to hear he's a Muslim. I could hear it. I got a part word knowledge, and I can hear also what the enemy's trying to do. I'll just be quiet. You tired anyways. You worn out. Look at you. He doesn't really care. He doesn't really hear. You know what I do? I get boisterous then. Because that ain't the Holy Ghost. I got enough sense. I grew up enough to recognize that is not how God talks.
Amen.
And so if that's not how God talks, then the only default is that here's what we think. That's what we think. That's how we talk. But you can't separate that out from the influence of the demonic. You can't. There is no such thing as a pure isolated thought that originated from you. There's no such thing. It's too impacted by your culture, by your environment, by the people who taught you, by the people who influenced you, peers. And that's too much influenced by the God of this world, the spirit that now works in children's disobedience. Give me a break. The only distinction is the word of God, hearing the word of God and learning what the word, how God talks. The Bible taught me how God talks. It's spirit and life. I can feel it. Spirit, something you can feel.
Amen.
You can feel something in the spirit. I feel it. Some people understand it. They can really understand, oh, I feel fear. You fear feeling something in the spirit, and it's real. You don't say that's fake. Oh, that's just fear. That's fake. That ain't real. That's real. Spirits, feeling fear is as real as anything else to you. Are you listening to me? How about feeling love? How about feeling peace? How about feeling divine glory? I just took a big old breath and I let out the gospel. I began to talk to him. I don't just preach. I say, who are you? Who are you? If I don't have a word enough, who are you? What's going on with your life? I just find a new person. Where are you from? What have you been doing in your life? You had a family? Then I wait on the Holy Ghost. And then I start talking right to the heart because I'm looking for the key. See, God knows as soon as I start talking to a person, I'm looking for the key to their heart. I'm not talking to their head. I'm not a head guy. I'm a spirit guy.
Amen.
I'm a man of the spirit. I'm not a man of me. I'm a man of God. Hallelujah. You get the choice. You want to be a man of you? Oh, I'm just a man of me. How are you doing? I'm a man of me. How are you? You much better say, I'm a man of God. Amen. I'm a woman of God. I'm someone taught of the Spirit of God to speak by the Spirit of God. If you never learned love and compassion for people, you're never going to reach into their spirit. You're never going to reach in their heart. You're never going to reach into a place of caring for them. Because that's a connection. That they can't. They can't. They can't pay. They cannot ignore you. When the care starts being experienced, compassion begins to experience. I was playing golf with Adam one day, and I was just waiting. The whole time we were playing, some other guy had come along. The whole time I was just waiting on the Lord. What can I say to this guy? Because I could see where he was at. And just being an atheist. And, you know, Lord, how do you talk to an atheist? He didn't tell me that. I just got it in the spirit. How do I talk to this atheist? He's so set on his golf game, I don't want to aggravate him. It's aggravating for somebody to talk to you when you're trying to focus and you're doing bad. So at the end of the match, I just laid my hands on him. I said, I bless you in Jesus' name. He turned to me and said, what can you say against the blessing? That's what he said. What can you say against blessing? Because he was ready to say something against whatever was said. He was on the against side. God will show you. He'll show you. I mean, just get the name of Jesus in there somehow, in a way that you're touching people's hearts and touching people's lives. But how are you going to do that? There's got to be a love. There's got to be a caring. There's got to be compassion. Somebody says, how do you know when to talk to people? Well, here's you understand this. We go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. But there is a way of the preparing of the ground. And we reach to God for compassion. I'm looking to God to speak to this person out of my being. Not me speak to this person, but God the Holy Ghost to speak to this person out of my being. And I know he's going to speak to them out of his love and his compassion. So I'm looking to be filled with such love and compassion, such great concern. You start showing people love and concern, come on. I've watched too many people give folks the cold shoulder while I'm busy. Don't give somebody the cold shoulder. Get up there, put your arm around them. It's good to see you. I mean, how can you begin? How can you begin to think about how you yield your members as instruments of righteousness to be taught of God, to be ultimately now functioning in this beautiful righteousness and this holiness that you were born into, this purity, this love that's been poured out upon you so that you begin to behave yourself with the same kind of love and caringness and compassion that God extended towards us, to where that everybody becomes a friend, even the enemy. Uh-oh. Now we're going to need some help. We can't do that one on our own. I could be better to my friends, but how am I going to be better to my enemies? You know, somebody was talking about the other day on Facebook, Cal, that a page of the Bible was fused to steel on when the trade towers came down. Has anybody heard about that? Anybody ever hear about that? Huh? And it was the passage in Matthew, not to resist evil. If someone smikes, if someone hits you on the cheek, turn the other cheek also. Somebody said, oh, how can we do that and be a country? Very well. If we all got down on our knees and trusted God, he'd fight our battles. But we in a position where as a nation, we don't know how to go, you know, build up our own army and rely upon our own ability. Huh? That's not the way this nation began. And then I take it from the nation and bring it down to your individual state. Because ultimately, everything that all this is about is you and I learning how to trust God absolutely, because that's going to be a whole bunch of where the shaping is going to go on and where the challenges are going to go on and where the trying is going to go on. You know, I was meditating on that. I'm getting ready to close. Try to bring all these things, just different dimensions of this one subject together. But last night, as we were flying on our last leg home from Phoenix, I was just stuck. I was just meditating. I didn't have anybody to talk to. Late at night, everybody's sleeping. meditating on this. And of course, I was just meditating on it, reading it in Hebrew. But, you know, it's very, very accurate here, pretty close. And it came to pass that after these things, that God determined and decided, I will now examine him deeper. In King James, it says, God decided, or God did tempt Abraham. And in the Hebrew language, it's, I'm going to examine him in a deeper way. And boy, look at the examination. Because it all, when you look at the origin, you look at where sin originated, it was all about not being willing to trust God. Another idea came along and said, you know, God doesn't have your best interests in mind. He knows in the day that you eat thereof, you should be like him. He's trying to hide something for you. All the inference and innuendo that is behind what's said there in this verse of scripture. And it became sin and a transgression because man decided not to put his whole trust in God. And so all Father doing is bringing us back to a place where we're going to be willing to trust him. Because if you're not going to trust him, you can't walk with him. You can't walk with him. You're not going to be shaped by him. Not going to be taught by him. Walking in spirit, relying upon God, saying, Lord, I'm going to do it like you said to do it. I may not understand it. I'm going to tell you right now, I've never understood hardly anything God said. I just did it. I just obeyed. What, am I supposed to understand everything? Come on. Come on. Who do we think we are? We think you're that smart? You know, I don't understand it. Well, fine. What difference does that make? Do it. You children, you say to your children, make your bed. Well, I don't understand why I need to make my bed. I'm just going to get in it tonight and mess it back up again. I don't understand why I need to put the toys up because I'm going to need them later anyways. I just got to go back in here and pull them back out. So now I've got them laying out here and they're easier and more accessible and I can remember which one I want to play with. You don't go in there trying to get some logical explanation. You say, do it. Do it. So the Lord brings him all the way to the point and said, now take Isaac, offer him. Now God's going to ask Abraham to do something that's out of his character, that's out of God's character. That's going to really mess with you. Huh? It's one thing just obeying God and it's everything lines up with who he is and the way he is. But now he's going to ask you to do something completely out of his character. Sacrifice my son. Like the nations that you abhor, who sacrifice their children unto the gods that are no gods, that are demon power. He knew the voice of the Lord. And I love this scripture because in scripture, there's this word that he uses for wood. It's this wood, the word he uses for wood, that literally can also be translated corpse. That moment that God asked him for Isaac, Isaac became a corpse. And he journeyed 3 days to Moriah, the day of resurrection. Isaac was already dead. In his mind, he was already dead. He was a corpse. And he said, because he's moving in faith. He said, you guys stay here. Isaac and I, my son and I, we're going to go yonder and worship. He was a country guy, so he said, yonder and worship. And we will return again unto you. We will return again unto you. Where? Father, behold the fire, and behold the wood. But where is the sacrifice? The Lord will provide a sacrifice. Whew. He actually said, where is the lamb? He said, the Lord will provide the lamb. Where is the sacrifice of the lamb? It's literally what he says. It needs to be translated that way too. Where is the sacrifice of the lamb? The Lord will provide the sacrifice of the lamb. Whew. I believe it was that day Jesus was talking about, and Abraham saw my day and rejoiced. I believe it was that day. I believe it was that day. That place of ultimate obedience. Somebody said, why do you believe that? Well, there's indication in scripture, but I've understood this. As I obey God and I let go of my life and I obey him to do what he wants, I get to see more. I get to see a whole lot more. And when you get to see more, you get to move in it. Till then it's aloof. It's like, well, how do you do that? God, I want to do that. Obey. Obey God. Step after obeying God. None of it has strengthened you right now in Jesus' name. Don't sit there and try to go thinking through how you're going to obey God. Open the Bible and just do what God says to do. I want to read these verses of scripture to you. And as I said, because I got this Bible to read Ephesians chapter 4, verse 24 to you. Somebody said, well, you would be a more effective minister if you could stay on one topic. Well, thank you. I appreciate that advice. Why don't you go ahead and talk to the Holy Ghost and talk to God and give him some advice to help me? Because I'm dependent upon him, and I am what I am by him. Amen. Amen. And I'm sure that he could use your help in understanding how to make me better. Amen. So, and I pray in the name of Jesus that you also trust yourself to God, the Holy Ghost. You won't try to keep second-guessing yourself. Just give yourself over to God and say, wow, Lord, you're making an amazing thing of me. Huh? Satan's trying to make you look awkward. God is saying, you treasure. Huh? You treasure. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 24. Scripture says, verse 23, he says, now be renewed in the spirit of your mind, or start thinking about yourself differently. Okay? Start thinking about yourself differently. And really, you understand this, dear people, this is what the scripture says. Start thinking of yourself differently. Based upon everything that God has said about you, stop thinking about yourself based upon everything that you've come to learn or believe about yourself as you've been taught by this world system. Once again, shaped in iniquity. Shaped in, and more than influence, controlled by the God of this world, the spirit of disobedience. And put on, look at this, and put on or be clothed with. Hallelujah. See, the miracle of the new birth in practice is the walk of obeying God and believing God's word, believing what he said about me. Because Satan's going to say, that ain't you, that's not who you are. He's going to try to show you the old person. Everybody around you is going to try to show you the old person. And you got to say, I don't even know what you're talking about. You're out of your mind. I don't even know. You saying that's me? You talking about somebody else. Because it's so settled in your spirit that you are different. You're a new creation. You're a new person. You don't even want to think about that or discuss those things, those former things. Because they all passed away. You don't want to look back and turn into a pillar of salt. Because you're so convinced of what God has done. And then that way, when Satan begins, because it's happening there in that dimension of your life, and Satan comes in your thoughts and starts trying to accuse you, you are absolutely as insane as I've always thought you were. I can't even believe you are absolutely, you got the wrong, you're so clueless. You got the wrong address. You're trying to deliver mail to the wrong address. Be clothed with the new man, which is after God, which just like God, which after God, which looks like him. Is created in righteousness and truthfulness. Look at the gift. I didn't spend a lot of time talking about the gift of righteousness or the gift of holiness, but just look at the conclusion of the gift that has been given to us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. See, if a man will confess with his mouth that God, that Jesus Christ is Lord, and believe in his heart that God raised him up from the dead, he'd be delivered. Because it's within that the deliverance is found. Deliverance from the kingdoms of this world. Hallelujah. For with the mouth confession is made unto the deliverance and made unto the salvation, and with the heart man believes unto righteousness. Who are you? Who do you belong to? What do you believe about yourself? Well, I believe I'm unclean. Well, then your father is the devil. You belong to a camp called darkness. There is an opportunity for you to believe in the blood of Jesus Christ and call upon the name of Jesus Christ and be cleansed from your sin, and now believe what God says and describes about you, that the Holy Ghost would teach you and establish in your life. Now, you're being taught of God. People got to decide whose side they're on, whose voice they're going to listen to. What spirit is going they going to let teach them? You're born in sin and shaped in iniquity when you were born of flesh and blood. But when you're born of the Spirit, you're born in righteousness to be shaped in purity. To be taught of the Holy Ghost, to be raised up by the good word of God. I'm not listening to anybody who wants to try to put any yoke of slavery upon me, anything that looks like iniquity or the old man, anything that looks like any kind of claims. I don't care who they are. I don't care how beautiful their frame. It doesn't matter. I'm wholly leaning on Jesus' name. I'm not talking about no soulish nature, no fleshly kind of living. I belong to the living God. I'm spirit, soul, and body His, transformed by His glory, made in His likeness. Hallelujah. Given everything that belongs to Him, and I won't allow any other claims to be executed against me. I won't allow any other thoughts to be that which would take hold of me to control me. No, if I trip up and sin or fail, I'm just going to turn and just that much with that much more intensity grab hold of Him and depend upon Him. Yes, to be taught and shaped in all His ways, to recognize all that is in the world, not in my heart. All that is in the world, in my heart, is Christ Jesus. This is His temple. All that is in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And yes, it comes with great force to try to take hold of me. Yes, it tries to impose upon me its wickedness. Yes, it would come to try to claim me and take me back. But it can't have me. I'm given over to be taught of God. I'm learning the ways of righteousness. I'm learning the ways of holiness. I'm learning like Jesus how to hate evil. Huh? And love righteousness. He learned obedience to the things He suffered. I'm learning obedience. He never failed, and yet He learned obedience. Well, I'm learning obedience, even though I fail at times. I'm still learning obedience. I'm going to learn an obedience to which I never fail. Not because of anything that I have in my own human discipline, but because I've come to a place of that much more absolute dependence upon the Holy Ghost, living this life by Him, for He alone can handle the knowledge of good and evil. You and I cannot. He alone can handle the knowledge of good and evil. And this is where people mess up. They don't understand. They've never brought in to their ideas and concepts and understanding of the Word of God the fact that when we are born again, even though we're delivered from every power of sin, yet we still have the knowledge of good and evil, something that we were never supposed to have. And only the Holy Ghost can master that realm so that we'll hate the evil and love the righteousness. Hallelujah. Come be taught of God. Come be shaped. Come give yourself desperately to walking in His ways, to learning His compassion. Recognize, let God show you where you're not walking in deeper compassion. Recognize, listen, I don't care how much compassion you have. It can get deeper. It can grow. It can mature. I don't care how much love you're walking in. It can get brighter and more beautiful and shine with greater splendor. I don't care how much joy you have. God wants to make it greater. How much peace you have. God wants to make it greater. Amen. Kindness you have. Goodness you have. I don't care how much blessing you have. God wants to bless you more. You don't see anybody getting upset about that. You know what I'm saying? I don't care how much blessing you have. God wants to bless you more. People aren't getting defensive about that. But you start telling them, I don't care how much love you have. You know, God wants you to have more love. And people get defensive. I don't care how much you think you know about Jesus. He wants to show you more. Sometimes people get defensive. You know what that is? It's a manifestation of religion. Because pride is in religion. And in such a terrible way. They walk together. Poverty is in there too. A poverty mentality, even if they have enough food to eat, you know what I'm saying, place to sleep and car to drive. So there's a, you know, a stinginess. The nature of God is such a giving nature, isn't it? Huh? Would you be willing to be taught of God? Would you just recognize today that you were born in righteousness to be shaped in purity? That you never want to, for one moment, to go back to learn how to be more like the devil? Huh? That to this day forward, you just be so consecrated. I want to learn how to be just like God. I don't want to be taught more death. I'd like to be taught life. I don't want to be taught more hate. I want to be taught more love. I don't want to be taught more sorrow. I want to be taught more joy. I don't want to be taught no more fear. I want to be taught peace. Come on. Huh? I don't want to be taught in the realms of all that destruction. Hallelujah. I'd rather have Jesus. And somebody acts like it's a hard choice. The world or Jesus? No hard choice. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather have Jesus than riches untold. Thank you, Jesus.